You're listening to the KSN Podcast, and today we're covering legislative updates for Illinois community associations. Welcome to the KSN Podcast, where you'll hear from KSN attorneys as they share their experience and insight on legal issues surrounding community associations, collections, property tax appeals, and landlord-tenant law. I'm Bernie, and today we are sharing the audio from our free webinar presented on January 25th, 2023. KSN attorneys Omar Malik and Joshua Weinstein addressed both legislative updates and case law updates impacting Illinois condominium, homeowner, and townhome associations. As a reminder, KSN is an experienced legal resource ready to provide board members and property managers with quality advice and exceptional service. We look forward to demonstrating how we have earned the trust of thousands of clients for over 40 years. If you would like to reach Omar or Josh or any of KSN's experienced attorneys, please call 855-537-0500. You can also visit ksnlaw.com and complete the contact form to send us a message.
Okay, welcome everyone who's joining. We'll go ahead and get started. I appreciate everyone joining. My name is Josh Weinstein. I'm a partner with KSN. My colleague Omar Malik will be presenting with me today. He's also a partner with our firm. And just a few housekeeping matters here. Tonight we're going to be going over legal updates for condominiums, HOAs, and townhome associations and other community associations in Illinois. We've got a lot to cover. To the extent that we have time, we have a lot to go over here. If we have time, we will we'll look at those questions and answer as many as we can at the end of the presentation. So one more housekeeping note. You can check out and register for future KSN events by visiting ksnlaw.com/events. Sign up for the newsletter to keep up to date so you can see when we'll be presenting again and the topics that we'll be going over. That's it for our housekeeping. So like I said, we're going to be going over legal updates, both in terms of statutory updates and as well as case law updates. And this is strictly for Illinois case law and Illinois legislation. So with that, why don't we get started? Omar is going to go through. First, we'll go over our legal updates here, our legislative updates. So Omar is going to get started with you guys on that. Omar, take it away here.
Thanks, Josh. So the first legislative update that we'll go through, it was known as House Bill 4158. Now it is part of Section 19 of the Illinois Condominium Property Act and Section 1-30 of the Common Interest Community Association Act, and it has to deal with the reserve study. So in its simplest form, this now requires, this is a mandate and required by both the Condo Act and CECA, that the association maintain a record of any reserve study that exists. So that doesn't mean that the association has to go out and get reserve study. It just needs to maintain a record of that. When we say maintain a record of it, that means that if an owner makes a Section 19 request to review records, they're entitled to receive a copy of that reserve study added to the list of documents, along with meeting minutes, association financials, ballots and proxies, so on and so forth, as a record that owners are permitted to review. And in addition, it also moves the expiration date for the Ombudsperson Act back by 2 years. So that was set to sunset, and that has been, the expiration date for that has been moved back 2 years to January 1st, 2024. The next item here, this was known as House Bill 5167. It is going to be effective on July 1st of 2023. This one's a little bit different than the previous item that we went through in that this one amends the State Finance Act, the Community Association Manager Licensing Act, and Licensing and Disciplinary Act. The difference between the old language and the new language is that previously a manager had to provide one, a certificate of fidelity insurance, and number two, a current certificate of general liability and errors and omissions to all associations no later than 10 days following the renewal date of the insurance. That last phrase is the key here, that no later than 10 days following the renewal date of the insurance. The proposed language to be effective July 1st of this calendar year would eliminate that 10-day requirement. It's simply those two items, the current certificate of fidelity insurance and current certificate of general liability and errors and omissions, would just have to be provided, period, as opposed to previously where you had to provide it within 10 days of the renewal. So that's the distinction. There's no affirmative obligation to provide it within that 10-day period. The next item here is a change that was enacted and effective on January 1st of 2023. It amends section 22.1 of the Illinois Condominium Property Act. And Josh is actually going to talk a little bit about the case that this change arose from later on in our presentation here tonight. Essentially, for those of you familiar with 22.1 disclosures, there's certain information that the association provides to a prospective purchaser within 10 business days of the request. This change to 22.1 caps the direct out-of-pocket expense that the association can charge to the requesting individual at $375. And you can also charge an additional rush fee of $100 for a 22.1 disclosure completed within 72 hours. So let's break this down a little bit. You always had to provide. So nothing's changed in the sense that the disclosures still have to be provided. Now, the primary difference is that there is a cap on the fee, the amount of fee that the association can charge to the person requesting the 22.1 disclosure. The fees still do need to be tied to the direct out-of-pocket expenses. So if the let's play this out. Let's say the association has a management company and the management company charges in their management contract, it says to the association that they charge, for example, $250 to prepare a 22.1 disclosure. That is fine. There's a direct fee that is being charged by the management company to the association. So that $250 fee could be passed on to the requester. The max could be is $375 under this revision, right? So if the management company, the direct out-of-pocket cost is $375, the association can then charge that to the requesting owner. So I've seen in my years of practice, I've seen some times where owners were charged $450, $550 for a 22.1 disclosure. So this was enacted in an effort to cap that and for there to just reinforce that there needs to be a rational basis for the fees that are being charged. You can't just pull a number out of thin air. One slight caveat that we don't need to talk about too much is that the fee being charged can be adjusted on a year-to-year basis based on the consumer price index. And then I think Josh is going to talk about some recent changes. I know I've been getting some questions about the smoke detectors and batteries.
Yeah, so we'll go to that. Thanks, Omar. A change to the Illinois Smoke Detector Act. It's called the Illinois Smoke Detector Act. One thing to note off the bat is much of what changed doesn't apply to condominium units in the city of Chicago because there's a specific provision in the act that was inserted, basically saying these new requirements of this section aren't going to apply to units and municipalities with more than 1 million inhabitants. Okay. So outside of the city of Chicago, this could have some impact, but basically what it does is the Smoke Detector Act applies to every dwelling unit, which includes condominium units. So for dwelling units that were in existence on July 1st of 1988, smoke detectors are required in dwelling units, and they can either be battery powered, as long as the battery is self-contained, non-removable, long-term battery, or is wired into the structure's AC power line and doesn't need to be interconnected. So that's one of the changes, is that the act was made more specific to describe, you know, what it means for these units that meet this standard that were in existence on July 1st, 1988. What sort of battery power has to be provided, and what wiring sort of system they need to have. The battery requirements apply to battery powered smoke detectors that are one, in existence and exceed 10 years from the date they're being manufactured, 2, fail to respond to operability tests or otherwise malfunction, or 3, are newly installed. So anything that meets that after July 1st, 1988 has to meet those requirements. For dwelling units that are newly constructed, reconstructed, or substantially remodeled after December 31st, 1987, so effectively from 1988 onwards, smoke alarms have to be permanently wired into the building's electrical system. And if more than one smoke alarm is required, the smoke alarms have to be wired so that the initiation of one smoke alarm will initiate all the smoke alarms in the dwelling unit. So if you've got 2 smoke alarms in a unit, they got to be set up so that one, if one goes off, it triggers all of them. And then for dwelling units newly constructed, reconstructed, or substantially remodeled after January 1st, 2011, smoke alarms that are permanently wired into a building's electrical system have to also maintain an alternative backup power source, such as batteries or an emergency generator. It's important to note that it doesn't apply to fire alarm smoke detectors or smoke alarms that are electronically connected as a part of a centrally monitored or supervised alarm system, nor do they apply to smoke detectors, smoke alarms, or other things that use a low power radio frequency signal or Wi-Fi to send and receive notifications from the internet. So just some slight changes. That law has been in effect for quite a while. There were just some slight changes to it with respect to, you know, the types of battery operations that need to, or battery power that needs to be provided to some smoke detectors, and whether or not some of these requirements apply to all units in the entire state or just apply to non-Chicago units. So the next thing we're going to talk about is a pretty substantial change to the property tax code, although this has sort of been sort of understood previously. But basically what it did was provide, there was a change to the property tax code. It affects condo associations and common interest communities and master associations, effectively now provide that the association can, on behalf of all or several of the owners within the association, file an appeal to the Illinois Property Tax Appeal Board. Ordinarily, the sort of the third step, if you're in Cook County, you know that you can file sort of, there's 3 levels. You can file an appeal with the county assessor. You can then file a subsequent appeal to the Cook County Board of Review. And then if you're not satisfied there, you can go higher up to the state. You can file an appeal with the Illinois Property Tax Appeal Board. So this is sort of, it's already codified in the Condominium Property Act that the association can file on behalf of the all of the units. Wasn't really something indicated in the property tax code for non-condominiums, but now it is with respect to appealing to the Property Tax Appeal Board of Illinois. The condominium associations, master associations, common interest community associations now have the authority to file on behalf of all the owners to PTAP. That does it for our legislative update portion. Now what we're going to do is we're going to move on to some case law. And Omar, there's a lot to discuss here. Some of this is pretty dense material, so we'll try our best to simplify as much as we can. But Omar is going to go through our first case here.
Sure. Thanks, Josh. So the first case here is Granville Tower Condominium Association versus Escobar. Quick side note, Josh and I were just down in New Orleans for the CAI annual law seminar. And at that presentation, there's all sorts of continuing legal education for attorneys, and they give a case law update at a national level because there's attorneys from all across the country that attend. It's funny, this was actually the first case that they presented during their national presentation. So this is a case that, you know, people all across the country are tracking just because of the implications. So its impact is being felt beyond just Illinois. So in terms of the case itself, this involved an association that passed a large special assessment. So it was a $4.15 million special assessment. Thereafter, there was actually an owner, there was an owner who did not pay their portion of the special assessment, and the association filed suit due to that owner's non-payment. Separately, that owner went into foreclosure, and there was a foreclosure action filed by the mortgage company. Subsequently, this owner named Escobar, so you see the Escobar name here in the case, Escobar bought the unit at a foreclosure sale, and she effectively tried to argue that the foreclosure extinguished her obligation to pay the special assessments that were owed for that particular unit, right? So she bought this unit at a foreclosure sale. There was this large special assessment, $4.15 million, and she's trying to avoid paying that. I mean, it's a fairly strategic move on her part. Her argument was really based on the fact that she's trying to claim that the special assessment was adopted prior to the foreclosure, and it was due when it was first levied. It was that she's trying to argue the special assessment amount was due when the special was first levied, therefore it be extinguished by the foreclosure sale. However, despite that being her argument, the appellate court, so this actually went up to the Illinois appellate court, disagreed and stated that the association, that the entire special assessment was not extinguished by the foreclosure sale. Here, in fact, the special assessment was due and payable in monthly installments. So they effectively said that if there was a payment due this month, it's due and payable in January 2023. There could be a payment due and payable in February 2023, so on and so forth. You cannot simply extinguish the entire special assessment because of how it was levied in this instance. So because there were monthly due and payable special assessment charges, the entire special assessment was not extinguished. A portion of it was predating the foreclosure, but the remaining special assessment payments continued to be the obligation of Escobar, who bought the unit at the foreclosure sale. So there may be some questions on this. This is something feel free to reach out to our office on, in the sense that it's fairly complicated. And a lot of you, for better or worse, do go through special assessments. So we can talk through the impact of a possible foreclosure on those special assessments. The next case, this one won't be as detailed of a description here. Holtgren versus 260 Jamie Lane Condominium Association. So Holtgren was the original developer of the association and in fact drafted the declaration for the association. So he filed a lawsuit in December of 2019 it was a deck action with the court, seeking to avoid having to pay assessments on the unfinished unit. So again, Holtgren is the developer. Some of the units were not yet complete, and he was trying to seek a deck action from the court so that he would not have to pay assessments on the units that were as yet unfinished. The court did not buy that argument. And in fact, they actually pointed out that it would be unfair. So if he owns 50% of the building, it would be unfair for the remaining 50% of the owners to shoulder the burden for his portion of the monthly assessments simply because he had not completed the unit. So there was, from an equity standpoint, it's fairly straightforward to understand the court's rationale here. So the bottom line is that the developer is not able in this situation to avoid having to pay assessments on units, even if those units are not finished.
Thanks, Omar. That's perfect. The next case we're going to talk about is a pretty fact-specific case. I don't want y'all to think that there's something to be taken and applied to, every association in the state necessarily here, but it's the Village of Downers Grove versus the Village of Square 3 Condo Association. What happened here is the village fined the association for failing to submit an annual fire prevention system inspection report as required by the village's fire prevention code. And the village said, well, even though the fire prevention system installed in this condo building in the 1990s was grandfathered from having to be upgraded to meet the new code, which that's the case in a lot of associations, a lot of villages where you have a building that's built up to code at the time, and then the code changes to somehow some system within the building that was met code at the time is now technically out of code if you were to look at things out of context, but you have some sort of grandfather provision which exempts the association in light of when they've put some system in place, right? So the village said, yeah, well, you're grandfathered in from having to upgrade your fire prevention system to meet the new code, but you're still required to have your system inspected annually. And the condo association said, no, we're exempt from having to have a fire prevention system at all because of how the buildings were constructed and when they were constructed. The village said, well, once the fire alarm system was installed and once it was approved, you couldn't you can't downgrade it. It's still going to be subject to these annual inspection requirements that are applicable to all existing buildings. And the appellate court agreed. It went to the appellate court. The appellate court agreed and said that even if the fire prevention code did not require a building to have a fire protection system, once an approved system was in place, the fire prevention code in this case required the system to be tested annually and a report required to be submitted to the village. Even though the association was grandfathered from having to upgrade the fire prevention system to meet the new code, they were still required to have it inspected and tested annually as the fire prevention code mentioned and required. The next case is a little bit of a complex one. Right off the bat, that the case ultimately was dropped by the insurance company. It's an interesting sort of thing to think about if you're a board member, you know, maybe involved in some litigation or have been involved in some litigation. We have a former board president of an association who sued the association and its current board members, asserting a whole host of claims, including that there was self-dealing, there was mismanagement, there was violations of the Illinois Condominium Property Act. They alleged that, you know, the association didn't reimburse him for nearly $17,000 that he advanced the board while he was a president, and that there was a board member that engaged in sort of self-dealing practices, and they violated the declaration and the Illinois Condominium Property Act by issuing excessive fines and on and on. So what happened was the association tried to get insurance coverage, right? We're getting sued. We're going to invoke our insurance coverage. So insurance company, you know, you need to provide us coverage under our directors and officers policy. Well, the insurance company said, hang on a second, we're going to sue. We need to sue the association seeking a declaration of no coverage. Basically, we're asking the court to declare we don't have to cover this defense of this lawsuit because there's an exclusion for an insured versus insured situation. So in condominiums in Illinois, your directors and officers policy covers not only the current board members for acts that they're doing while they're on the board, but also former board members in their capacity as board members when they were on the board. So what you had here was a situation where you have a former board member doing an association and current board members. So the former board member is also, you know, is insured, right? Because he's a former board member, and former board members are insured in their capacity as board members, acting in their capacity as board members at the time they are board members. Of course, current board members are insured. So the insurance company said, hey, court, we want you to say that we don't have to cover this case. We don't have to provide any coverage because we have an insured versus insured situation. There's an exclusionary policy that says if an insured wants to sue another insured, we don't have to cover it. They cited a bunch of different rulings and they said, hey, we have this insured versus insured exclusion in our D&O policy. It applies whether an insured person, such as the person who was suing the association in this case, brings a claim against the insured organization as an individual or as a trustee. It doesn't matter. They're still an insured. Ultimately, insurance company dismissed their case voluntarily. So we don't actually know what the court would have decided, but it's an interesting thing to think about that, you know, especially if you're a board member, there's maybe an instance where you're being sued, right? There's a potential that your insurance company, you're being sued by a former board member for things that happened while the former board member was a board member. There may be a situation where an insurance company tries to say, sorry, we're not going to cover you because of an insured versus insured exclusion. I mean, that exclusion is going to have to be in that D&O policy. But if there is one, that could come up. So just be aware. The next case that we're going to talk about here, essentially what happened here in 4043 South Drexel versus Burke. We have an owner who in 2006 purchased a unit and a series of corporate entities for which Burke served as an officer bought seven other units intending to rent them out. Those entities collectively owned a total of about 56% of the total association. Declaration, like most, said, you know, the association is initially supposed to be managed by a three-person board of directors appointed by the developer until the developer sells 75% of the units or 3 years after the declaration is recorded. After then, unit owners are supposed to elect a five-person board at each annual meeting or at a special meeting. In addition, special meeting was required to be called for the purpose of filling any vacancy on the board not later than 30 days after petition was filed by 20% of the owners. This is very standard stuff in condominium law and the Illinois Condominium Property Act. All this is sort of spelled out there. But the bottom line here is that in April of 2016, Mr. Burke said in an email, all right, we're going to have an association meeting. It's going to be held April 23rd. for the purpose of electing a three-person board. Okay, first problem, as some of you may know, is email notice is not really sufficient notice from a legal perspective unless you've got specific rules in place for doing that. So that aside, he sends an email, says we're having a meeting. At the meeting, three owners get elected to the board. Some conflicts arose between the owners and Mr. Burke regarding the management of the condominium association finances and Burke's rental of units that he owned or controlled. Burke rented more units than were permitted by the declaration without the board's consent. So the other board members took issue with that. So ultimately, Burke decides to resign from the board due to a conflict. And then you get two unit owners of this three unit owner board who then email all of the unit owners and conduct a meeting where they voted electronically after the meeting to adopt a new board or elect a new board, right? So you can see where there's all these missteps probably, right? Email notice, voting electronically, both of those things have to be codified in rules that are adopted by the board. Those things in general are important to remember here. And they're important to remember because what the appellate court ended up deciding is that the association, when they went to sue Burke, they didn't have standing to sue because they didn't have a properly elected board for the variety of reasons I mentioned. They didn't send proper notice. They didn't elect a full board. And there were supposed to be five members of the board. So the email notice was a problem. The electronic voting was a problem. Having only two board members was a problem at a time because two out of five isn't a majority. They couldn't even have called a meeting that way. So all of these problems led to the court saying, association, sorry, you didn't have standing to sue here because you didn't have a properly elected board and that board did not authorize, you know, whatever that board was, didn't authorize the lawsuit. Bottom line here, an association can't sue someone if there's not a properly elected board and if the properly elected board doesn't authorize the lawsuit. You got to make sure if you're a property manager, if you're a board member, and you're maybe a self-managed association, that your elections are properly noticed and held, that votes take place in accordance with the law, in accordance with your declaration and bylaws, and that if you're going to sue, that the board votes to do that. Ideally, in a condominium or in a community association subject to the Common Interest Community Association Act, you're going to have to vote on that, even though it is a lawsuit. You can discuss it in executive session, but you have to vote on it in open session in order to authorize any legal action. Make sure you remember that you've got to have a properly elected board and you got to authorize lawsuits in open session when you and if you need to. Omar's got another case here we're going to talk about.
Yeah, thanks, Josh. So the next one here is the title is Morgan's Orchard Lake Homeowners Association versus Morgan. So right off the bat, this involves a homeowners association and the Common Interest Community Association Act, otherwise known as CICA. So this actually has some pretty significant implications for those of you in the HOA world or if you're subject to CICA, just because it adds a wrinkle, to say the least, to the adoption process when you're adopting your annual budget. So I'll take you through the facts. So in 2019, this particular association ended up filing a collection action. So this is the origination of the case against this owner named Morgan due to his failure to pay assessments. Morgan responded that no assessments were due because the assessments were not validly adopted in accordance with the association's declaration. So while he acknowledged that the board had the authority to adopt the budget, he contended that it was done the incorrect way. So let me walk you through both what CICA says and what the declaration says. I will highlight for you the declaration language that this case really turned on. So for those of you, and there are some parallels between this case and the budget adoption procedure in the Condo Act. So it's worth listening to and being aware of, even if you're not in a homeowners association. So under CICA, to adopt a copy of your budget, it requires that a copy of the proposed budget be sent to each owner 30 to 60 days prior to the adoption of the board. We won't draw all the distinctions between this and the Condo Act, but right off the bat, you'll see those timeframes are slightly different. So here we're talking about CICA 30 to 60 days prior to its adoption by the board. Also, similar to the Condo Act, the board has the right to set the annual assessment rate, but owners can always file a petition or seek to overturn a special assessment that's adopted that would increase the assessments by more than 15% for the prior year. So that's just what SECA says. Let's actually dive into what the declaration said here and what the primary arguments in the case were about. So in this case, the Morgan's Orchard Lake Homeowners Association declaration provides two things. Number one, that the amount of the annual assessment was to be determined by the owners at any annual or special meeting called for that purpose. I'm going to repeat it again. The declaration provided the amount of the annual assessments was to be determined by the owners at any annual or special meeting called for that purpose. We're going to come back to that. And number two, that the assessment amount shall in no case be less than an amount determined by the board as necessary to defray the association's costs and expenses in meeting its obligations under the declaration and bylaws for the following year. So going back to that first portion that I read twice, the owner argued that there had been no meeting of the membership to vote on and approve the annual assessments. Rather, the board simply distributed the budget to everyone, approved the adoption of the budget, and therefore attempted to collect monthly assessments, in connection with that new budget. So here, Morgan paid that first quarterly assessment. So they had a quarterly assessment, but did not pay anything thereafter. So he acknowledges that the board has the authority or had the authority to adopt the budget. But then again, going back to that phrase I repeated twice, he argued that the board could not approve the assessment amount because the declaration unambiguously required owner approval. Again, just to repeat the third time, the declaration provided that the amount of the annual assessment was to be determined by the owners at any annual or special meeting called for such purpose. And in this case, that was not done. They did not have that owner's meeting for that approval of the ownership to occur. So as a result, the trial court granted judgment in favor of Morgan, finding that the acts procedure, so SECA's procedure, did not nullify the declaration's requirement. So going back to earlier, I outlined the procedure in SECA, and it was clearly different than the procedure set forth in the declaration. The declaration added another step where there needed to be approval of the assessment amount at an annual or special meeting called for that purpose. So here, Illinois Court of Appeals approved or agreed with the trial court, and it found that the declaration clearly and plainly indicated the assessment rate was to be determined by the owners voting at a meeting called for that purpose. So the takeaway for those of you on the line, if you're a homeowners association subject to SECA, you need to just double check that you're complying with the terms of your declaration. But this is just something to be aware of in the future to make sure that you're adopting that budget properly. So you cannot simply rely on, oh, I know what SECA says, I'm just going to follow what SECA says. In fact, it's a little bit more labor intensive, and you need to review the declaration to make sure that the procedure set forth in the declaration is followed as well. So in this instance, the proper way to have done this, to adopt the budget and the assessments, would have been to call two meetings. Number one, they first should have called a meeting of the owners, again, in accordance with that language from the declaration I repeated three times there. And number two, the board would then subsequently, it can be the same night, so you can have two meetings back to back, right after, hold a board meeting to adopt the budget and the assessment amount. In this case, because of the declaration language here, that would be the proper way to adopt the budget and the assessment amount. So the takeaway is just be careful when doing this in a homeowners association or an association subject to SECA. It just adds another layer of complexity. So when you're going through this year or next year, feel free to reach out to your manager, your attorney, and we can make sure we're guiding you through this so that the proper procedure is followed and to limit or prevent any challenges by owners. I think Josh is going to take us to the finish line with a couple last cases here.
And then yeah, and these next two are going to seem like a bad movie where there's like an ending that doesn't really resolve the problem that we're leading up to in the story. The first one, another sexy insurance company case, insurance company suing an association. But let's sort of get to where that comes in. So first, we've got an association, Bell and Arthur Condominium Association. They're in Chicago. We've got some unit owners in that association as well. The owners filed suit against the association and the board, saying you mismanaged the condominium, various other misconduct in the underlying case. So the association filed a claim with its insurance carrier, Cambridge. Cambridge filed suit against the association, and they say we want coverage of this lawsuit, right? Cambridge filed suit against the association, just like that other insurance company did in the Fireside case, and they filed suit against the association and the individual directors, seeking a determination that they had no duty to defend any of them in this underlying case filed by these owners against the association. Okay, so now we get into the nitty gritty of this case. The insurance policy for this association included business liability coverage under its master main policy, as well as directors and officers liability coverage under an endorsement to the policy. And all this is kind of technical insurance stuff, but we'll get to why this is important in a second. So under the business liability coverage aspect of the policy, Cambridge had a duty to defend both the association and its officers and directors against liability arising out of bodily injury, property damage, or personal injury. And in order to trigger coverage for that, an occurrence, in quotes, must have caused the bodily injury, personal injury, or property damage. So an occurrence was defined in the policy as an accident, including continuous or repeated exposure to substantially the same general or harmful conditions. So we have a lot of sort of defined terms, occurrence, accident, certain types of injuries, right? All this comes into play here as to whether or not there should be coverage or whether or not Cambridge thinks there should be coverage. So Cambridge, the insurance company, asserted that the owners didn't allege any type of injury or damage that would trigger coverage under the policy. Amongst other things, the owners alleged in the underlying case that the association violated the Chicago Municipal Code by failing to provide hot water. And they said ever since they moved in 2014, the owners had problems with hot water. The problems worsened over time until a defect in the main pipes was discovered. And they claimed the association failed to fix the problem or evaluate whether a boiler should be replaced. And so the owners alleged, the boiler failed in the middle of winter, causing them to lose hot water and suffer sickness, distress, exposure to cold weather, and on and on. Association said that, well, these allegations qualified as property damage and bodily injury. Well, the court initially said, we disagree. We think the owners did not allege that an accident occurred, which was required to be considered an occurrence, which would have triggered coverage. The owners didn't allege what caused the boiler to fail. Their allegations were mostly about the boiler being replaced at the wrong time rather than damage to the boiler causing their injury. And the condominium documents required the association to maintain, repair, and replace the boiler from time to time, something that is expressly contemplated, the court said, can't qualify as an accident because it's not an event that is unforeseen or unintended or unexpected. So an association replacing a boiler, which or replacing some aspect of the property, which led to them not having hot water, court basically is saying, well, that's not an accident. That's not an accident that would have triggered coverage under this policy. In the underlying case, they had a contractor testify who said the boiler replacement work would damage the owner's unit, and the association agreed in advance to repair the damage. So when the association was doing all this work in the underlying case, or what led to the underlying case, they had a contractor that said, if you replace the boiler, it's going to damage the owner's unit. So they agreed to advance in advance to repair the damage that would have been caused. The owners claim the association failed to repair that damage. Nonetheless, the intended and expected property damage did not qualify as an accident. So Cambridge had no duty, the court said Cambridge had no duty to defend either the association or the directors under the business liability policy. However, if we go back to what we initially talked about, there was a director's and officer's endorsement on the policy, which had a different standard for coverage. The endorsement insured against liability arising from wrongful acts of the quote insured. The insurance company said the endorsement imposed a duty to defend only the directors and not the association. But the endorsement used the term in quotes insured in lowercase and without quotes, insured in lowercase, no quotes. And that term insured wasn't defined in the endorsement's definition section. The endorsement stated that the words and phrases that appeared in quotation marks had special meanings, and the court determined this implied the words without quotation marks had no special meaning. So there was no special definition of insured here. So the court applies that definition in the main policy, which defined insured, as the association along with its officers and directors to mean the same thing for the endorsement. It means association and its officers and directors. But the court also said that these claims by these owners for a breach of contract, right, they failed to follow the provisions of the declaration, didn't qualify as wrongful acts, but some of the owners' other claims potentially did qualify. The owners claimed the directors adopted rules through procedures that violated Illinois law, and the insurance company said that all the claims involved alleged intentional or fraudulent conduct, which were not covered by the policy. But the endorsement, remember, specifically defined wrongful acts as including any negligent act, any error, omission, or breach of duty. So there was disagreement about whether the word negligent was intended to modify only an act or also an error, omission, or breach. That's a little aside, but the court found that the allegation would be covered under either interpretation regardless. So an alleged failure to follow a rigid procedure or a law in adopting rules qualified as both an error as well as a negligent act. And so the court said that even weak claims here implicated the Cambridge's duty to defend. And the claims in the underlying case have to be liberally interpreted in favor of providing coverage for the insured. And they also said if one claim in the underlying case triggers coverage under the policy, the insurer has to defend the insured against all of the claims. So what did the court actually do here? Well, the court denied Cambridge's motion for summary judgment. Cambridge basically said, court, at the outset, there is no genuine issue of fact here or genuine issue in dispute here, which you have to decide. Here's all the facts. It's clear you can make a decision off the bat without even hearing the case on the merits. Court said, no, that motion's denied. Do we know whether they have a duty to defend or not? No, we think they will. We think they do, but the case had to be heard and decided on the merits because there's a genuine dispute as to whether the insurance carrier had a duty to defend. So the motion to dismiss was denied. Like I said, not a great payoff for all of that explanation, is it? So the last case, probably the one that was causing the biggest consternation amongst management companies and amongst associations. Omar mentioned it at the outset that I was going to address some case that related to the 22.1 disclosures or the 1-30 disclosures in SECA related to excessive fees. In this case, is Shannon versus Westward Management. So you got owners in a condominium association. They're selling their units. They go under contract in condominiums in Illinois. The Illinois Condominium Property Act Section 22.1 requires a seller of a unit to get specific documents and information from the board related to, you know, various disclosures they have to make about the property, right? And with that, before this year's new law went into place about the amount of fees that can be charged, what the act said is the board can charge a reasonable fee for the direct out-of-pocket cost of providing the information that they're required to provide under Section 22.1 of the Condo Act. So what the association did here, like many associations who have a management company, is they said, okay, we're going to direct you to the management company who's going to handle this, and they're going to supply the information and the documents. The management company then charged a fee for the production of that information and those documents. And the owners, the sellers, said, you charged us a $245 fee. We think that fee is excessive, but we were forced to pay it just to satisfy our obligations under the act. So, but we're suing Westward because we think Westward violated the act and the Consumer Fraud and Deceptive Business Practices Act by charging unreasonable fees for statutorily required documents. What Westward did is they said, wait a minute, the Illinois Condo Act doesn't create a right for an individual to sue the management company for this. So we want court, we are asking you to dismiss the case. They file a motion to dismiss. The sellers, they don't have a standing to sue the management company, right? Essentially implying they should have sued the association, not the management company. Well, the court said, no, we're not going to grant your motion to dismiss, meaning we're not going to say outright that this person, these Shannons, do not have a right to sue you, but we'll put the underlying case on hold, give it to the appellate court to decide that part of it, whether the Shannons have a right to sue Westward, whether a unit seller has a right to sue a management company for anything related to Section 22.1, but specifically excessive fees. So put the case on hold until the appellate court answered that question. Question posed, did the act create an implied cause of action in favor of a unit seller against the manager as the agent of the association for charging excessive fees? There was a whole test they used. appellate court said Westward could be liable under the act if it actively participated in breaching the association's duty, because Westward was essentially the agent of the association. So Westward did have to fulfill the duties that the association otherwise, or the board otherwise, would have had to, because they were just the agent of the board acting for in the stead of the board in this case. But again, they didn't address whether the fees were excessive. So the appellate court said sellers were members of the class that the statute was intended to protect. It was intended to protect sellers. And typically, because sellers lack the access to the information they're seeking that they need to disclose, they needed to get it from the management company, of course, or from the board. But because Westward allegedly charged fees in excess of the direct out-of-pocket costs permitted by the act, the Shannons say, well, we potentially incurred the type of injury the statute was designed to prevent. The appellate court said, yeah, we think so. But Westward then filed leave to appeal to the Illinois Supreme Court, which the Supreme Court granted. The Supreme Court then noted that the Condo Act placed a ceiling only on the fee charged by the association. No mention was made of any fees charged by a manager. So in this case, the association chose not to fulfill that duty itself, right? The association didn't charge any fees. It was the manager charging fees essentially on behalf of the association. And to be clear, the Shannons, these owners, these sellers, did not pursue a claim against the association, right? They pursued, they chose to pursue only the management company, which is part of the problem. The Supreme Court said it's practically unimaginable that the mandated disclosures in 22.1 were intended to protect anyone other than the potential buyer. These disclosures are really something that you're providing so that the buyer can make an informed decision about whether or not, in light of what you're disclosing, they want to continue with the transaction. And the Supreme Court said they could discern no benefit to unit sellers by the statutory disclosure time limits or the fees or anything like that. Although the Shannons maintained that the monetary limit was plainly intended to benefit the sellers by making the requisite documents more affordable for them to obtain, that language could just as easily be viewed as aiding potential buyers by ensuring that information critical to their purchasing decisions is readily available. And they said the legislative intent of the disclosures was to primarily benefit the unit buyers, but the single benefit arguably bestowed on the sellers and the reasonable fee requirement was merely incidental to the underlying purpose of the resale, right? The fee part, right? The reasonable direct out-of-pocket expenses, that part of it was just an incidental benefit. The real purpose of this provision of the law was to inform buyers of certain things that may exist or not in the property. Ultimately, the Supreme Court held that the Condo Act did not create a private right or cause of action, an implied private right of action by a seller against an association's agent, against a management company for violating the act's disclosure document fee limit. What does that mean? Well, the association or the board was the party obligated by the act to provide the disclosure document to a seller, and they're the ones subject to a fee limit. The association or the board is the party against whom the seller, the Shannons, had recourse for allegedly charging excessive fees. Right? Not the management company. There was no private, the Supreme Court said there's no cause of action against the management company here. The management company is just doing what they're contracted to do as the agent of the association. It's the board who has a duty to adhere to the statutory provisions of Section 22.1 by not only providing the information, but by adhering to the dollar limits, right? Which we know now, $375 is your max. $100 for rush fee, rush service within 72 hours. So what ultimately is the bottom line here? Well, the Supreme Court reversed the appellate court judgment and the case was remanded to the trial court for further proceedings. Again, not a great payoff for all that explanation. So basically though, the thing to understand is that the unit seller doesn't have a right to sue a management company for violating Section 22.1. The trial court's gonna have to decide on whether on the underlying issue of whether fees were excessive. Right, they may have to amend their complaints, but basically the seller doesn't have an implied right of an action against the management company for violating Section 22.1. So that's the long and short of this. Go to our website. You can find both Omar and my information on the website. And if you have specific questions about your association, you want legal guidance about, you can feel free to reach out to us. If you're a manager or if you're a board member and your board needs assistance, feel free to reach out to us and we'll do our best to answer you as quickly as we can. So thank you again, everybody. There are a lot of you here. We really appreciate it. And we appreciate you guys hanging on here while we got through some of this pretty dense material. Make sure you keep up to date with all of our upcoming events and webinars that we're going to have, and we'll see you guys very soon.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, everybody.
The music for this show is provided by podcastthemes.com. Please note the material contained on the KSN podcast is for informational purposes only and does not constitute legal advice. No attorney-client relationship is established by your review or receipt of the information contained on the KSN podcast. You should not act on the information discussed on the KSN podcast without first obtaining legal advice from an attorney duly licensed to practice law in your state. While KSN has made every effort to include up-to-date information on the KSN podcast, the law can change quickly. Accordingly, please understand that information discussed on the podcast may not yet reflect the most recent legal developments. Material is not guaranteed to be correct, complete, or up to date. KSN reserves the right to revise or update the information and statements of law discussed on the podcast at any time, without notice, and disclaims any liability for your use of information or statements of law discussed on the podcast, or the performance of the podcast generally. The KSN podcast may be considered advertising in some jurisdictions under applicable laws and ethical rules or regulations.